Since the tropical forest is, in the words of Dr. Mayers, the powerhouse of evolution, several species of life face extinction as a result of its destruction. And because the trees are being cut, there is deforestation, and due to this, the forest area has shrunk. Because of that, those species, animals, and the birds which were living in these forests are losing their habitat, and not only that, they are even losing their lives. And because of that, some of the animals are already extinct, some of the species also are extinct, and others are on the verge of extinction. If the forests are not there, these animals and birds which we see now shall not be there either in future. It has been well said that forests precede mankind, deserts follow. The world's ancient patrimony of tropical forests is now eroding at the rate of 40 to 50 million acres a year. And the growing use of dung for burning deprives the soil of an important natural fertilizer. The World Bank estimates that a five-fold increase in the rate of forest planting is needed to cope with the expected fuel wood demand in the year 2000. So this paragraph gives us the data about how much forest area we are losing. In a year, we are losing 40 to 50 million acres of area per year. There is deforestation going on, and the World Bank estimates that a five-fold increase, that means five times, there has to be afforestation so that many more trees are put up, because by the year 2000, which is already passed, the fuel wood demand had increased. And because of that, the World Bank estimated that there have to be a number of trees, a number of plants planted to get back that forest area which has been cut down. James Speth, the president of the World Resources Institute, said the other day, "We were saying that we are losing the forest at an acre a second, but it is much closer to an acre and a half to a second." So John Speth gives us another data. He says that we are losing forest area not just 1 acre a second, but it is 1.5 acre per second. And this also tells us that not only the public has to take care, but these people who are giving us the information, even their information has to be preserved and has to be thought over very carefully. Article 48A of the Constitution of India provides that the state shall endeavor to protect and improve the environment and to safeguard the forests and wildlife of the country. But what causes endless anguish is the fact that laws are never respected nor enforced in India. This paragraph tells us that the Constitution of India put up an article 48A in which it said that the state must take care of wildlife and safeguard the forests. Take care of the forest area too. But all these rules and regulations are there only on papers. The people, the public, the government cares little for all these rules, and that is why there is so much of deforestation and wildlife is unprotected. For instance, the Constitution says that casteism, untouchability, and bonded labor shall be abolished, but they flourish shamelessly even after 44 years of the operation of the Constitution. There is one rule in Constitution which says that there should not be any untouchability or casteism and bonded labor. But what is the result? The result is that the people have not cared for this rule either, and untouchability still exists. Bonded labor and casteism also still exist. Because the people do not care for any of the rules and regulations put up by the government or by the other agencies and the Constitution. This is shameful for the people of the world. A recent report of our Parliament's Estimates Committee has highlighted the near catastrophic depletion of India's forests over the last four decades. Another report tells us that even in India, the forests have been cut down. The forest area has shrunk in the last 20 years. India, according to reliable data, is losing its forest at the rate of 3.7 million acres a year. So the data tells us that in India also, 3.7 million acre has been lost in a year. That is, in this area, the trees have been cut down and the forest area is no more to be seen. The actual loss of forest is estimated to be about 8 times the rate indicated by government statistics. And whatever data is given by the government, we feel that it is 8 times more than what the government statistics says. That is, there are more trees cut down than what is presented in the news or in the newspapers. And because of this, the forest area is fast shrinking. That forest area, which is officially designated as forest land, has no trees at all at this time. A 3-year study using satellites and aerial photography conducted by the United Nations warns that the environment has deteriorated so badly that it is critical in many of the 88 countries investigated. Well, there was another investigation done, another report came up, and this 3-year study with the help of satellites and aerial photography, they took the United Nations to photographs of these 88 nations. And what did they find? They found that most of the countries in these 88 places, the environment has depleted and there is a lot of pollution found in these places, due to which it has become critical living in those areas. There can be no doubt that the growth of world population is one of the strongest factors distorting the future of human society. So this paragraph gives us the information that this is all because of the population explosion. More the people, the more this environment will be depleted and will come into a critical condition. It took mankind more than a million years to reach the first billion. That the world population around the year 1800. By the year 1900, it was 2 billion, and the 20th century has added another 3.7 billion. The present world population is estimated at 5.7 billion. Every 4 days, the world population increases by 1 million. So here comes the data of population, which is increasing day by day. In the year 1800, it was 1 billion. In 1900, it reached to 2 billion, and in the 21st century, it was 3.7, and now it is about 5.7 billion. And it is reported that every 4 days, this population increases by 1 million. And this gives us an idea of population explosion. Fertility falls as income rise, education spreads, and health improves. Thus, development is the best contraceptive, but development itself may not be possible if the present increase in number continues. So, this paragraph tells us that if this population increases in this at this rate, then even the development would be very difficult, because the development can take place only when the society is educated and the income rises. If there are more of poor people, obviously there shall not be any development at all, because those poor people will remain uneducated. The rich get richer and the poor beget children, which condemns them to remain poor. More children does not mean more workers, merely more people without work. It is not suggested that human beings be treated like cattle and compulsorily sterilized. But there is no alternative to voluntary family planning. Without introducing an element of coercion, the choice is really between control of population and perpetuation of poverty. So this paragraph tells us that the rich get richer because they are educated, they get better work, they get white collar jobs, work, and therefore they still get richer in the society. But what do the poor do? The poor feel that more the children, the more the hands to work, and there'll be more income. But it is not so. The more children that come up into this world remain uneducated because of poverty, and therefore they remain as poor as ever, because they do not get work according to the society, according to the status that the rich are getting, and therefore they remain poor. The only way to control this growing population is voluntary family planning, because human beings are not animals that they would be compulsorily sterilized. And therefore, the human beings have to give a thought to this, whether they should control the population or whether they should remain in poverty forever and forever. The choice has to be there between these two. The population of India is estimated to be 920 million today, more than the entire populations of Africa and South America put together. No one familiar with the conditions in India would doubt that the whole of the people would die in their hungry hutments unless population control is given topmost priority. So this paragraph tells us about the population of India, which is more than 920 million today. And if Africa and South America population is put together, even then India's population is more than that. And it is very difficult for these poor people of India to be better in any way, and they should know that their hopes too would die in their hungry huts, because their hopes would not be able to be fulfilled as they are not educated as they are not getting that much of income to let their hopes flourish. And therefore, population control is very much required in India. For the first time in human history, we see a transcending concern, the survival not just of the people, but of the planet. But here, this paragraph tells us that there are a number of people, a number of agencies who now feel that not just the people are there to survive, but it is the whole of the planet that has to survive. And unless this planet is cared for, human beings will not be able to survive here at all. It would be very difficult for them to survive on this earth. We have begun to take a holistic view of the very basis of our existence. The environmental problem does not necessarily signal our demise. It is our passport for the future. So it says over here that people have started looking at this planet as one whole, not as parts at all. And it says that this planet Earth is the very basis of our existence. If this Earth is in sickness, we people also would not be in any better condition. We too would be facing a number of problems in future. And therefore, we have to take care of this Earth very much in this present times. It is a holistic view, an ecological view, seeing the world as an integrated whole rather than a dissociated collection of parts. It is just a repetition that this planet has to be taken as a whole along with the human beings, other species, the plants and the trees and every other thing that is present on this earth. We cannot take us people as a separate part of this earth at all. We have to consider ourselves as one of the parts of this one planet Earth. Industry has a most crucial role to play in the new era of responsibility. What a transformation would be effected if more businessmen shared the view of the chairman of DuPont, Mr. Edgar S. Woolard, who 5 years ago declared himself to be the company's chief environmental officer. He said, "Our continued existence as a leading manufacturer requires that we excel in environmental performance." So it is Mr. Edgar who says that unless these businessmen and these industrialists also take care of the environment, we shall not be a leading manufacturer at all. Because it is these industrialists who have to take up the responsibility in this era of keeping the environment pollution free. And if this happens, only then we shall excel in environmental performance. Of all the statements made by Margaret Thatcher during the years of her prime ministership, none has passed so decisively into the current coin of English usage as her felicitous word, "No generation has a freehold on this earth. All we have is a life tenancy with a full repairing lease." In the words of Mr. Lester Brown, "We not inherited this earth from our forefathers, we have borrowed it from our children." So Margaret Thatcher says that it is the generation that does not stay on this earth forever and forever. It is one generation that stays here, and by the time the next generation comes up, it is an era which has passed. And therefore, what is our duty? Our duty is to take care of this earth keep repairing this earth and the things that we are living and we are using, because these things have to get repaired for the future generation that is to come up, because no generation lives on this earth forever. Then Mr. Lester Brown also tells us that this earth we have not inherited from our forefathers, but we have borrowed it. It is to be kept safe for our children who are coming up in the future generations.